if you've been looking for a new cassette deck in the past few years, without spending a lot of money, you probably ended up seeing something very similar to the two decks I have here. These decks are sold under many different brand names around the world, such as Ion, Pile, Marantz, Renkforce, and I'm sure there's even more than that. These decks actually have much longer history than many people think, since most people have only ever seen these in the past few years. Ever since the big brand names in audio such as Sony and Pioneer stopped selling their cassette decks over a decade ago, these are pretty much the last ones left available for under $200. But the basic design of these decks actually dates back to at least 1991. One of the users on the tapeheads.net forum was able to find a Soundwave DD1200 deck from 1991 that looks virtually identical to these decks, and it was originally part of a rack system of components, including an amplifier, a tuner, a CD player, an equalizer, and the cassette deck, that were all sold together under many different brand names back in the 1990s and early 2000s. I was really surprised to discover that even Wharfdale, the famous British high-end speaker manufacturer, sold an equivalent rack system of components, and that system even included a matching turntable, although it was definitely rather grim as it used the same basic low-end mechanism as used today in all-in-one systems by brands like Crosley and Victrola. And I found this photo of someone who bought the entire system from Wharfdale and has set it up in a rack. And you can see at a distance, it actually looks quite a bit more high-end than these components really are. As for where these component systems were originally sold, in the UK, the Wharfdale components were sold by Argos, and in Germany, the Soundwave and X4Tech brands were, and the Renkforce brand still is sold by Conrad Electronic. While here in the US, I never saw them in major electronics retailers like Circuit City, or The Wiz, or Radio Shack. I think these were the kind of systems that would have been sold at Joe's Stereo Shop on the other side of the tracks, or even by the guys that did the white van speaker scams, because some of these components definitely have that kind of appearance. For example, in the official stock photo on their website of the Pile PT600A amplifier, they misspelled integrated as integrated, and multifunction as multifunction, and it has this sticker saying high fidelity. Thankfully, in actual photos of these units, it seems that they did fix the spelling mistakes and they did remove the high fidelity sticker. But on their spectrum analyzer, they misspelled analyzer as analyzer, and according to the one blurry photo I was able to find of the actual unit, that spelling mistake was carried through to the actual production models. And their attempts at making these components look more professional by adding rack mount ears to them is quite laughable, since they're so obviously just tacked on the sides. For an idea of the kind of prices that these stereo components originally sold for, I found an MCM Electronics catalog from the mid-2000s. They were selling the amplifier from the Pyramid brand for $109, the cassette deck from Pile for $89, the AM/FM digital tuner from Pyramid for $74.95, and the CD player from Pyramid for $126.25. The most obvious quirk of these cassette decks that can be traced back to their origin as part of a matched component system is that there is no recording monitor. When you record something to tape on these, you cannot hear what is coming through the input, through the output jacks of the tape recorder. And when I first noticed that with this Ion deck, I thought there was something wrong with it. I thought there was an electronic problem on its circuit board, which is one of the reasons why I wanted to get another one to see if it had that same flaw. And indeed it does. In fact, all these do. That's because with the original stereo system these went with, there was no tape monitor button. You were always listening to the source whenever you were recording the tape, so it did not need a tape monitor coming out of the cassette deck, so they never bothered to put one in. So originally that wouldn't have been a problem with the system these were sold with, but now that they're sold individually, if you try to record something onto them, you're not going to hear anything coming out of the output. You're going to need to connect these to a similar kind of stereo system, or a mixer, or some other kind of device that allows you to monitor the source while you're recording it to tape. So that really helps to put in perspective the original design intent of these cassette decks. They were never really meant to be sold on their own as individual components. They were meant to be sold as part of a rack system of matched components, all from the same manufacturer and designed to work together. That's why, for example, you see that they're quite a bit shallower than most other individual audio components, because normally you have to consider people would have different makes and models of components of various sizes. So even if the cabinet ends up being mostly empty space inside, you would still want it to be a bit larger to support larger components that people would have in their systems. But if it's all sold together as a matched system, then they're all going to be the same size, so then it doesn't really matter if they're smaller than normal. So that explains why these are quite a bit shorter front to back than you would expect. And one annoyance you may encounter when using one of these decks on their own is that the combination of the lightness of the unit and the stiffness of the buttons means it'll tend to slide around on you when you're trying to use the buttons, which is quite annoying. But when using these decks with other components stacked on top of them as they were originally designed, the extra weight holds them down, so that's no longer a problem. You can press the buttons and it won't slide around on you. And that's also why some of these decks have this remote system jack, which is usually not even explained as to its purpose, but that was designed to allow the matching amplifier to control the cassette deck via a remote control. Also, you may wonder about the knockout plug on the front panel of these decks. This was actually originally intended for a microphone input, although I've never actually seen one of these decks with that microphone input installed. For some reason, that's just not a feature they ever equipped on these decks, even though it was originally planned for it. So that's why they all end up with this blanking plate here on the front panel. And the final quirk that I never knew the reason for originally is that the recording level control has a center detent position. And normally, if you ever recorded something to tape, you know that different sources have wildly different audio levels, so you'll need to adjust the recording level individually for each source. However, with a matched component system, they can match the output levels of all the components, so that's not an issue. So generally, with the systems these were originally sold with, you could just leave it in that center detent position and you wouldn't need to worry about it. But nowadays that people are using these decks on their own to record, don't assume that the center detent position really has any meaning anymore. You will need to adjust the recording level appropriately for each source that you connect to it. And originally, among the low-end brands that sold these stereo components and systems, there were actually multiple tiers of cassette decks, of which this common style you see today was actually the lowest-end model. The next step up lives on today as the Pile PT659DU, and in Europe as the Auna Master Tape and the Rankforce TP1010 USB. You can see it has a slightly larger cabinet with a more rounded front panel. It has a soft touch power button instead of a toggle. It's actually a momentary contact button, so I believe the system could automatically turn this on along with the rest of the components. And it has slightly nicer feeling buttons on the decks, but otherwise, internally, it's basically identical to these. And then the next step above this was a model with auto reverse playback. Those have all been discontinued by now. And then even above that was a model with soft touch, full logic, solenoid driven controls instead of these mechanical push buttons. It also had auto reverse recording, automatic tape type selection, and Pile even shows their version of it, which was the PT689D, as having the Dolby B noise reduction logo on the front panel, although their description of it on their website, which still is online today even though it's been discontinued, makes no mention of that, nor does the owner's manual. So I don't know if that was just wishful thinking on the part of the mock-up they did, or if it actually did have Dolby noise reduction. So over the years, all the other matching components these were originally sold together with, such as the tuners and amplifiers and equalizers and CD players, were gradually discontinued due to lack of interest, but by the late 2000s, all the major brands in audio, such as Sony and Pioneer and Onkyo and JVC, had all discontinued their cassette decks, and suddenly, if you're looking for a new cassette deck for under $200 or so, these were the only ones left, whether you like them or not. So it's really quite unfortunate that only the cheapest of the cheap cassette decks from the 90s have survived until today, and that there is really nothing between these low-end decks, which typically sell for around $100 to $150, and the TAC and Tascam decks, which typically sell for $350 and up. But in the meantime, I've officially launched my entry-level cassette deck buyer's guide webpage with all of the data I've collected on these decks, as well as my recommended alternatives to these decks if you'd rather just avoid them entirely. So be sure to have a look at that. I'll include a link to it in the description.